every time, no. I would like to personally welcome you to Man Hour at the Dark.
Say that
thing. Why bring you the host, Mike, Buck, and Cone?
You know we're coming more to the
stage. Sports talk than what you about to hear right here. I second that.
Go. You know that it's us when we talk about sports. Giving you facts on the field to the core. Tune in, we need the support. 1 hour too short, then listen some more. On all your stations, not dropping no music. Stripes like Adidas, but Nike just do it. Down 4 and 4th, we go for the win. Michael, 2 seconds, we taking it in. Buck, Mike, and Combs, you know what's going on. Man, now we're out the dark, no LA, we the big spark. No 4th and inches, won't cut short. Got the best talk, and it's all sports. Buzzing more than buzz beaters. We coming live, all through your speakers, go.
And what is up, everybody? Michael Buckeyes are here with the Man Hour. Head over to manhour.com. Pick yourself up some merchandise. But first things first, though, you got to welcome Brandon Combs onto the show. Brandon, what's going on, man?
What is going on, Michael Buckeyster? What a weekend we had. A little sad on Saturday, but a little happier on Sunday.
And then a little less happy on Sunday because we welcome Wyatt Williams to the show. William. Wyatt Williams, what is going on? Why do I always want to call you William? That's so freaking
weird. I don't know, man. I had a lunch lady back at my school who did that all the time. Oh, but hey, I wanted to start the show showing Combs this right here.
I have a lunch good, lady, he says. I have a lunch lady.
That Wyatt. Was a lunch lady? Oh, my
Wyatt.
God.
Why? What do you got? You got your own personal cook at home now, Wyatt?
No.
Are you like one of those rich young kids that just gets to do... Look, you're 12 years old. You got a podcast out of your bedroom. Like, and now you've got a lunch lady? No, Wyatt, she's called Mom. Stop calling your mom Lunch Lady.
And the show already takes a left turn real quick. Guys, welcome to the Man Hour. This is the second to the last show for the year of 2020. We have taken big strides, big up and downs, but we are looking up and up in the 2021 year. Big things happening. But Wyatt, first things first, man, Christmas is just a few days away. Friday is Christmas.
Pumped.
What did you ask Santa Claus for Christmas, man?
Jesus Christ.
A later bedtime, man. And a Packers Super Bowl. That's all I want. Two things. Later bedtime and a Packers Super Bowl. Other than that, I think we're doing fine.
Oh, well, that's what you came up with, Wyatt? That's what you came up with to ask Santa? A Packers... What you should have asked him for was an offense to surround Aaron Rodgers and a defense to go with it. Because they're not getting a Super Bowl.
Oh,
that is true. You guys probably won't even get a first round win, to be honest with you.
Oh my, y'all. Yeah, you're right. We won't have a first round win because we ain't playing the first round. You're right. We ain't getting a first round win. We're not having a first round loss either. We got that bye.
Welcome Tory Anderson to the show. Combs is just Mitchell Trubisky, but fatter. Wow. Shots fired already.
Wow.
Thank you, Tory, for bringing a smile to my face right now. That is awesome.
This is just Mitchell Trubisky. Wow, that's rough.
Is that a water boy or the third best quarterback in the NFC North?
I don't know who Tory Anderson even is.
That's all right. Oh, Professor Leonard comes in with Henry is greater than the Packers defense.
He is. Look, but to be fair, Wyatt. To be fair, if I played the Packers 16 times, I'd have 1,000 yards rushing too because they can't stop anybody.
That is very, very true.
Hey, I will say you're not wrong, man. And we play Tennessee.
Tory Anderson, you talk about the Bears. You can talk about Mr. Trubisky. But do not come at me about my Cubs, man.
Hey, I'm with you on that one, Cubs. I'm with you on that one.
That's all right, guys. Man. So obviously,
fire.
Combs is from the Chicago area. And for some reason, he's a Notre Dame fan, which is kind of weird to me because they aren't really close to each other, but whatever. I digress.
I'll let you pick on my girl and my kids before I let you pick on the Cubs.
So, obviously, guys, let's talk a little bit about college football playoff here. Notre Dame did squeak in as a 4 seed, even though they got throttled by Clemson on Saturday. You have Ohio State at the number 1 seed, Clemson at number 2, 3 was Ohio State, and 4th was Notre Dame. So you have Alabama versus Notre Dame and Clemson versus Ohio State in the playoffs. Combs. There are a lot of people saying that Notre Dame shouldn't even be in there because of the slacking they took from Clemson. Defend your team, man. Defend your team.
if you can sit there and say Notre Dame does not belong, and look, I get it. They took a beating on Saturday. I mean, it was not a pretty game for them offensively. Defensively, they didn't play horrible. I mean, when you hold, you know, the god Trevor Lawrence that everybody likes to make him out to be, hashtag bust, and you hold him down to 34 points and that Clemson offense down to 34 points, you're doing something okay. By the way, they scored more points on Notre Dame with their backup quarterback. I'm just going to throw that out there as well. And so Notre Dame went out and they had a bad game. The offense finally had a bad game this season, and that was their first bad game. But if you're going to tell me you're okay with Ohio State being in there but not Notre Dame, you are out of your freaking mind, okay? And then the only other team that really belongs in there is Texas A&M, and they belong in there over Ohio State, not Notre Dame. You can't tell Notre Dame, hey, your best win of the season is against Clemson, and your only loss of the season is against Clemson. You're 1-1 against Clemson. So now we're going to knock you out of the playoffs. But, you know, the 6-0 Ohio State Buckeyes – other than Zen, have nothing going for them. And they go out and they beat pretty much, you know, the Perkins School for the Blind. I think they play twice. Then they beat Penn State, who lost their first five games of the season and then finished 4-5. So they did not beat anybody this season. Not one team. And not only that, but they shouldn't have even been in their conference championship game. They had needed a rule change for that, and now they're getting another rule change for the college football playoff so that their freaking players can play in the damn college football playoff game. Give me a break. Ohio State is the team out of the four that does not belong in there. It's not Notre Dame. You can cry all you want, but year after year, Notre Dame plays one of the toughest schedules in college football, and they did it again with the ACC this year. They beat Clemson in the regular season, and you can cry all you want. Oh, they didn't have their quarterback. They didn't have the quarterback. Well, tell the quarterback not to catch freaking COVID, and then he would have gotten to play. That's not Notre Dame's fault. They beat them.
Pick me, please.
Deep breath, relax. We don't want you to have a heart attack because you are over like 50 years, like years old. Calm down. And I have to agree with Tori Anderson here. He said Indiana was robbed because of the money. Why?
I agree.
Give us some real knowledge here, man.
Combs. They have been. You said they had a bad game. They have been terrible in big games with an S. This is what Notre Dame football is. They beat a couple of good teams. Like you said, they play a pretty tough schedule. They beat a couple of good teams in the regular season. They get to the big game, a.k.a. Clemson, the last two times that Trevor Lawrence played, and they get throttled. Notre Dame is not a playoff team. They are all smoke and mirrors. They play good in the regular season. When it comes to the playoffs, it's
so a 10-1 team shouldn't be in, but the 6-0 team should be in. And by the way, they shouldn't have even gotten their sixth game. They should only be 5-0. But they got gifted a game and got gifted a conference title game at that.
Okay.
So let me jump over to the chat here. Let me jump over to the chat here. And Tori Anderson says Indiana was robbed. Tim Leonard said Indiana was robbed. Blake Zender says Indiana was.
They were.
Like robbed.
They were.
Pake Smith says that Indiana should have been there as. Like as well. What's up, Grandma? Tell Wyatt to go to bed. how can Indiana be robbed if they were not in the Big Ten? Like they should. I've been on both sides of the fence, and like I agree, but I'm playing devil's advocate here.
Indiana Ohio State beat met Indiana. The requirements.
Okay,
here's the deal: you don't send your weakling to war. It's just that simple.
That's not what it's about, though. They say time and time again, what does the NCAA say? It's about the players. It's not about the money. It's not about this. That's why they said, oh, this COVID thing, we're not gonna bend rules. Their big thing, especially in the Big Ten, the holier-than-thou Big Ten, we are not going to change our rules. If you get COVID that week, you are forfeiting but you're not playing your game that week. And you are not playing. Michigan, did they change the rules and let Ohio State in, but now they're changing the rules to let the kids who have COVID play in the damn game.
The only reason why we're stuck on this Ohio State thing is because Michigan, who is their arch rival, better till the end. I mean, in Ohio, they don't even say M, anything with an M, in Columbus on Michigan week. They don't do it. Michigan forfeited the game because they could screw Ohio State over. Did you know their gym was open the day before and the day after the Ohio State game? I thought they were quarantined.
We actually did talk about that.
But Indiana Indiana was 7-1. Indiana met all the requirements they needed to get.
Who was the dash one?
Okay, Ohio State.
Well, Ohio State was undefeated. It's not like Ohio State lost to Indiana and they needed that extra game to get the push. They beat them.
Yeah, and then they struggled against Northwestern, big powerhouse.
So
how many players out, Buck? 28?
Yeah, like
you didn't even know that till before the show. Don't use that stat.
But still. Okay, so actually during the game, if you would watch the games, Combs, did you actually watch the game, the Ohio State versus Northwestern game? Okay, so during the game, when Ohio State had that delay of game penalty, the color commentator said that they had three assistant coaches out as well. So Ohio State was playing very shorthanded. Are you telling me at full strength that would have been the same game?
So the team that got gifted a game had to play shorthanded?
Aw.
Hold on. So, world's tiniest violin playing the world's saddest song.
What is the world's saddest song? Is it Look What You Made Me Do by Taylor?
It's the Ohio State fight song.
So first things first. Okay, so I didn't think Texas A&M was getting into the college football playoff simply because they got their throttled by Alabama earlier in the year. Like, I think the only team besides Notre Dame that legitimately had a shot was Cincinnati. But then they threw Oklahoma up there at a number 6 seed. What was that all about? I mean,
it's
Oklahoma
8-2,
like Cincinnati was.
It's because of the name. It's because of the O and the U. They wanted the biggest names they can. Like Combs said, the NCAA preaches how it's not about money. But at the end of the day, no matter how much they say that, it's about money. No, everybody knows that, okay? And that's exactly what it was. They wanted the biggest names in there. They wanted the Ohio State, the Oklahoma, the Clemson, the Alabama, the big names. They wanted them in there. So they'll give Oklahoma their little push and keep them into the thing. They'll keep the overrated Spencer Rattler in the contention. But that's all it is. It's just
do you know how the NCAA could have avoided all of this and still got their wish with Ohio State?
Don't say
there?
Eight teams because that's not the answer.
Eight teams.
No.
Eight teams is absolutely the answer. If you go to eight teams, nobody even bats an eye that Ohio State is in there, except for maybe Coastal Carolina if they get left out of it. Nobody bats an eye that Ohio State is in there if you have eight teams. Nobody bats an eye if Notre Dame doesn't get knocked down to seven. Nobody bats an eye then. But because they're at four and because they're at three, my problem is everybody's like, oh, these are the teams that should be in. You know, Florida should be there because they played Alabama. Well, Florida has two losses. You're not going to throw a two-loss team in over a one-loss team, especially when that one-loss team is the pedigree of a Notre Dame.
So let me address this comment here before Wyatt has to go to bed, says Timothy Leonard. Tori Anderson says, college football is all about what you've done for me lately. Early season losses is not as bad as late season losses. I do agree with that to an extent.
If that's the case, why isn't A&M there over Notre Dame?
That's so,
that, I mean, that I defeats that argument right there because A&M's loss came early against Alabama, and then Notre Dame's loss came in the last game of the season championship game. So it's not that. It's about the names, and it's about who's going to bring in the most money. I'm sorry, but A&M's a big school. I like Texas A&M. I would have loved to see Kellen Mond in the playoffs. Kellen Mond versus Trevor Lawrence, to me, would have been the best. Because I think A&M would have won that game. But I think that the thing is that Notre Dame brings in more money than Texas A&M does at the end of the day. You're going to bring in more viewers. You're going to bring in more money. They travel better. It's just that's just how it is.
So let me bring up some other things that happened over the weekend before we go to our first break here. We have seen many streaks of conference championships in a row. Oklahoma now has six. Clemson has four in a row, and there was another
Thanks,
team.
Anna.
Yeah, and there was another team that had six in a row as well. The name slipped in my mind right now, but this is between Oklahoma and Clemson. Which streak of conference championships in a row is better? Why? Oklahoma or Clemson? Like Oklahoma has six in a row, Clemson has four in a row. Which streak has been better?
That's tough, honestly, because when you look at the Big 12, defenses don't exist. And when you look at the ACC, good teams don't exist. So I would say probably Oklahoma, because at least there's a couple of other big teams in it. I mean, you know, Baylor was pretty good last year. There's been a couple years where they've had a couple of other good teams in there. I mean, Texas had a couple.
Did you just say the ACC doesn't have good teams?
Yeah, who do they have?
Miami, Florida State,
what is Miami
Clemson?
Before
the last,
this year?
Last 4 years, they haven't done nothing. There's been nobody.
What are you talking about? Maybe it wasn't last year, but at least 2 years ago, they were fighting for a college football playoff spot.
It's just Clemson. That's all it is.
Oh, come on, man. Every conference has three really good teams. Every conference has three really
good
teams.
Who are the ACC's three good teams?
Okay.
For the ACC,
I just said it
all the time.
Well, right now it's Notre Dame, Clemson, and
Notre Dame's not a part of the ACC, so get that name out of your mouth.
Well, they are. They are right now, and they are when they play college basketball. So, but you go Clemson, Florida State, Miami.
Okay. And just to address Corey's comment, Big 12 is not trash. Big 12 is better top to bottom than most of the conferences in all of America.
He just said defense doesn't even exist in the Big 12. Now you're going to say they're better than the ACC?
They can beat
Clemson
all the ACC
teams. Destroy
teams.
Oklahoma.
All right, whatever. With that being said, guys, this is the Man Hour. We're going to take a quick little break. On the other side of the Man Hour, we have the world-famous Way or No Way brought to you by Big Dog Poker. We'll be right back.
Way or No Way is brought to you by Big Dog Poker. Head to bigdogpoker.bet and use agent code TSS _Combs and deposit your first $50 today. Receive up to 20% of rake back for every hand you play at cash tables. That's bigdogpoker.bet, agent code TSS _Combs.
No way. Yes way.
All right, guys. So we had this conversation a couple weeks ago about tanking in sports. And I am a big believer that other than maybe in basketball, because that's probably the most fixable sport of them all, that there is no tanking in football. Teams don't want to go 0-16. Players don't want to go 0-16. Players want to beat their rivals. Players want to beat the better teams. They want to do it every week. So that being said, the first way or no way here, the Jets win versus the Rams proves that there is no tanking in the NFL.
No way. All it shows is Adam Gase sucks so bad as a head coach that the guy can't even lose correctly. We've known he can't win. We all know that. We saw it everywhere he's been. In his entire career as a head coach, he is more likely to lose by double digits than to even win the game that he's playing in. So all this proves is he sucks at winning because he can't do it. Now he sucks so bad he can't even lose correctly. I mean, so no way. It's crazy to me.
Yeah, the correct answer is no way. There's definitely tanking in football. I mean, look what the Jets did versus the Seahawks just a couple weeks ago. They were in a position to win the game, and they call out a all-out blitz, and then they fire the defensive coordinator because he made a bad play call. Well, Adam Gase told him, hey, we need to lose this game. Come on, man. Do a little something, and I'll pat you on the back later. So definitely way there is tanking in NFL. Look what the Browns did for many, many years. How many number one overall picks did the Browns have in the 2000s? Come on, Combs. There's definitely tanking in football. There's tanking in every sport.
First of all, I give you guys a softball, and you both blow it. I understand Wyatt because he's up 2 hours past his bedtime, but Buck – like, I mean, this was a softball, and you blew it. The answer to this is absolutely way. There are – and Tory Anderson, even though I don't want to give him any credit because he called me fat earlier, front offices want to go 0-16. Players want to win, and that's the truth. And ultimately, the players are the ones on the field. Do the front offices want the number one draft pick? Of course they do, because that's how you get better. It's through the draft and through building your franchise. However, the New York just don't know how to build a franchise. The New York Jets, don't matter who they draft, they are not going to be a relevant team for at least the next 5 years. So it doesn't matter what they do. So there is no chance in hell that you're going to tell these players in the Jets organization to go out there and not win. Not going to happen.
Are you ready for some real knowledge here, Combs? You can say players can win all they want. Yes, that is true. There's a competitive nature in all players. But who signs their paychecks at the end of the day? It's the freaking front office. Who does the, so when you see Jerry Jones walk down from the press box down to the field, it's like, hey, Jerry, Jason Garrett, hey, hey, we need freaking Zeke. Go ahead and lose a couple more games. Come on, you know that happens. So don't even give me that. And the coaches call the plays and put the players in the bad spot to lose a game. So there's definitely tanking. Come on. Definitely tanking.
Incorrect. Jeez.
You are so horrible at your life.
Next.
No way. Yes way.
All right, sticking with the theme here and the draft. Whether it's the Jets or the Jaguars, Trevor Lawrence should go back to Clemson and hope next year he gets picked by a better organization. Way or no way?
I'm going to say way, but if he does choose to not do that, I think the best thing he can do, pull an Eli Manning. Just say, I refuse to sign with one of these teams. He'll get a lot of crap for it, I'm sure. Positive of it. Eli did. But here's the deal. At the end of the day, your career isn't wasted. And that's really what matters. If he goes to one of these organizations, we've seen it. These careers are just getting wasted away. Sam Darnold, I think Sam Darnold's a great quarterback, and I think he would fit well anywhere else. But the problem is he just got Adam Gase sitting over top of him, and I think it would be the same thing if Trevor Lawrence went there, even with Jacksonville. It's just the fact that they don't have good players to surround these guys with, and they waste their careers.
Yeah, and Wyatt knows all about wasting careers over there with Aaron Rodgers with like one Super Bowl win. So, I mean – the worst thing Trevor Lawrence could do is go back to college because of the risk of tearing an ACL, like an Achilles or a knee or a shoulder, right? That is the biggest thing to hurt your career is going back to college, not getting paid as much as you will in the NFL, and then getting a season injury or a career-ending injury, ACL, knee, elbow, whatever. So nonetheless, like, I don't think any those two teams would take a quarterback anyways. They're going to trade down to get more draft picks, much like what Miami did. So Trevor Lawrence should definitely go into the draft 100%.
So when I first started these Way or No Ways on Triple Shot Sports, Wayne G was my co-host, and he used to have this whole thing where he would never pick a way or no way, which is always goes, well, kind of way, kind of no way. Well, that's where I'm at with this one. It's kind of way and kind of no way. Look, if you're Trevor Lawrence, you don't want to go to the Jets or the Jaguars. However, you also don't want to go back to school. And so I think you have to do whatever you need to do to get into the end of the draft and make the money. But I don't think it matters anyway because I think Trevor Lawrence is a bust in the NFL. If I'm him, I'm taking the money and I'm getting it while I can until people find out that I suck at the next level.
No way. Yes way.
All right, boys, it's getting to that time of the season again. We have got a big playoff push coming forward. We've got a couple playoff spots still available in both conferences. So I'm going to ask you this one. The Miami Dolphins will hang on to the final playoff spot in the AFC. Way or no way?
I absolutely do think so. It is, it's two a time in Miami. Defense looks great. It's on fire right now. Plus, they get the big man. They get Gaskin back this week. But we all saw what Ahmed did last week. I believe it was like 150 yards, something like that. So they got two awesome running backs. They got a decent wide receiver core. But yeah, I think it's two a time, and they're going to turn this around. Carried by the defense, it's gonna take them to the playoffs.
Wyatt, clearly you don't know football very well at all. You have to learn how
He's
to.
He's a Packers fan. That goes without saying.
Yeah, you have to learn how to lose before you know how to win. Much like the Kansas City Chiefs had to lose that AFC championship game versus the Patriots to win the Super Bowl and this year's Super Bowl as well. So the Miami Dolphins have to blow this playoff berth that they have, and I think the Raiders are going to slide in there. We saw Marcus Mariota come in for an injured Derek Carr and do really, really good, and the Raiders are the most scariest, sneaky, underrated team out there, and do not let them end the playoffs because they could upset a team in the first round. I don't think the Ravens have it. They're going to lose to the Jaguars this week, actually, and the Miami Dolphins lose, their next two games. I believe they played the Buffalo Bills the last week of the season, if I'm not mistaken. But I think the Raiders slide it in there.
And you're both wrong once again. So here's why the Miami Dolphins don't get in just because of standings and because they're going to lose the tiebreakers. So here's the thing. Tennessee, Indianapolis, Cleveland, Baltimore are all going to be 11-5. And that is going to knock the Miami Dolphins out of it. The Miami Dolphins are going to end up being 10-6, having a great season, having a season that really, to be honest with you, I'm not sure anybody really saw coming. But they are just going to miss that playoff spot. And the funny thing is that if Tennessee, Indianapolis, Baltimore, and I believe it was one other team, if they all go 11-5, somehow even the Browns miss the playoffs as well. So that's the most Cleveland stat of all Cleveland stats, but somehow Cleveland could also be 11-5 and get knocked out of the playoffs. So I don't think Miami hangs on to that final spot. And it's just because other teams, the Cleveland Browns have an easy schedule down the stretch. I think they have the Giants and the Bengals left. The Ravens. They have the easiest schedule left, and so I think they'll get that last playoff spot.
No way.
Yes way.
All right, guys, sticking with that same thing, let's head over to the NFC here. The Arizona Cardinals will hang on to the final playoff spot in the NFC.
Wait. The Cardinals have a dynamic offense, and when Kyler Murray is healthy and looks comfortable in the pocket, like we just saw this last week, they are a dangerous team with an electric offense. I mean, Kenyon Drake, Chase Edmonds at running back. Then you got the wide receiver core, which is ridiculous, with Hopkins, Kirk, Larry Fitz. I mean, it's crazy. And then Buda Baker on defense. They got a pretty good defense that'll carry them the rest of the way, I believe. But this team is definitely dangerous.
They are dangerous, but they are on this a roller coaster of a ride. Earlier in the season, they were up, and then went way down, and now they're going to be up. And when it comes time for that final playoff spot, they're going to go down. You know what? Just to make Brandon Holmes mad, Mr. Trubisky is going to lead the Chicago Bears to the playoffs, get that seventh spot, and they're going to get an ever horrible draft pick, and they're going to draft let's say a backup kicker for their first overall pick because the Bears suck at everything else. So you want to talk about teams sucking that suck at sucking? The Chicago Bears suck at sucking because they're going to get into the playoffs and not do anything with it. Bears, Bears
pick
get
that
in.
Kicker from Purdue with the first round draft pick. I hate to agree with Buck here, but he stole my thunder because that's exactly where I'm going. The Arizona Cardinals have two divisional games left. The Bears have tough the Jaguars division. And then the Green Bay Packers. The Green Bay Packers are not going to need Week 17. The Green Bay Packers are probably not going to play their starters in Week 17. The Bears are going to beat the Jaguars. They're going to beat the Packers in Week 17. And they are, unfortunately, going to head into the playoffs. Well, they'll probably, end up, doing something stupid like, beating a team in the first round and then upsetting the Packers in the second round because the Packers can't win a home playoff game to save their life and then end up losing an NFC title game or something. They're going to do something stupid so that they end up with, the 28th overall draft pick and we end up with, some freaking defensive tackle from God knows where freaking university.
God. They are not going to the NFC championship game, Combs.
Shut up, says the guy who said the NFC champions going there.
They are.
No way.
Yes way.
All right, guys. Last one here. The NFC East, or NFC Least, however you want to call it, can be clinched this weekend. If the Washington NotRedskinsAnymore win their game, and the Giants and Cowboys both lose. So I ask you this. The Washington NotRedskinsAnymore will clinch the NFC East in Week 16.
Way. If they get Alex Smith back. I said this last week. I got a lot of ridicule for it. Okay? But if Alex Smith is the man in charge of this offense, then the team is great. They're an awesome team. The defense is there. They have some great running backs in Gibson and McKissick. Scary Terry is a beast of wide receiver. Thomas is a top five tight end this year in stats. All they need is Alex back. Because we saw it. We all saw it. Haskins threw more picks than touchdowns this weekend. He is not a good quarterback. I mean, they competed with Seattle, a division leader in the NFC West, which is a tough division. They competed with Seattle without Alex Smith. If they had Alex Smith, they would have won that game. But Haskins, inaccurate as you know what, throws the ball God knows where, and then, you know, they look terrible. He threw more picks than touchdowns. So I'm going to say way if Alex Smith comes back.
So you are correct about Alex Smith. He definitely changed that Washington football team 100%. I said with Alex Smith as a starting quarterback, the Washington football team are a playoff-bound team. But the reason why I am throwing red flags at Washington right now is because they're saying it's a strained calf. Ron Rivera said he could have played last week, but they're taking it easy on him. You are in the middle of a freaking playoff hunt. You should not be taking it easy on a starting quarterback whatsoever. And I know we have some Eagles fans in here. They are not going to win the division whatsoever because they're going to lose to the Dallas Cowboys this week. The division winners are going to be the Dallas freaking Cowboys. I told you guys this a month ago. We saw the Dallas Cowboys hit 41 points versus a stingy 49 defense last week. They're going to do it again versus the Eagles. They're going to do it again versus the Giants. And the Eagles and Giants are all going to lose. Everything is going to go the Cowboys' way. They're going to get into the playoffs. They're going to go to the freaking NFC Championship game because the NFC Championship game representative is going to come from the East. And you guys know it.
Hey, I just got a phone call. It's the 49ers. They were calling me to ask if I can come play for them. Because everybody's hurt. Of course the Cowboys beat them.
On the offensive side, everybody's hurt. The only thing they're missing on the defensive side is freaking Nick Bosa. And you just run the other side of the field and you're perfectly fine. Jesus. Cowboys win this division. They win it soundly. Hell, they might lock it up this weekend.
Oh, my God.
I mean, they can't.
I don't know what you do, but Blake Zender, I hope you're listening right now, buddy.
He's over there in the comments. He says
he's here.
The Washington NotRedskins anymore lose this week to the Carolina Panthers. The Philadelphia Eagles beat the Cowboys.
Lies.
The New York Giants lose. Next week, the Philadelphia Eagles beat the Washington NotRedskins anymore to rip this division out of their hands and do the most NFC East 2020 thing they could do and come back and win this division when they are dead in the water with Jalen Hurts. Jalen Hurts is a stud. Jalen Hurts is exactly what Philadelphia needed 3 weeks before they actually inserted him into the damn lineup. Jalen Hurts is the reason why Philadelphia is going to come back and win this division. Sorry, Buck.
Sorry, but you are wrong because Carson Wentz is starting this week versus
the
Cowboys.
I love the Chiefs, and then when the Chiefs aren't on, I love the Dallas Cowboys. You and your boy LeBlanc over there who likes to wear his Cowboys undies, and then he dons his little Packers nightie after the Cowboys lose.
Go Pack,
so,
go.
Get out of here with your two teams. It's going to be ugly. It doesn't matter who wins this division.
It matters who wins this division because the winner of this division is going to the NFC Championship game.
They're going to get
listen to what I'm telling you. Listen.
They are going to lose the wild card game to whoever they have to play in the
wild card
game.
You guys, I literally give you knowledge on a plate for free every night, and you are not taking it. If you want to take this bet, take it. NFC East Championship or winner is going to go to the NFC Championship game.
I'll take this bet, Buck.
And it's going to be the Dallas Cowboys, 100%. The Eagles are complete trash because they're starting Wentz because he's crying like a little bitch.
What are we putting on this? What are we putting on this, Buck? What are we putting on this, Buck?
I mean, I already shaved a beard once. Let's freaking shave the heads.
We got to talk off air. We're going to get something going.
We're going to get something going.
No. Here's the deal, guys. The only way the NFC East the NFC East winner will win their playoff game, one playoff game, on one condition. If it is the Washington NotRedskins or if it is the Philadelphia Eagles with Jalen Hurts, those two teams will win their first playoff game. Other than that, there's no way an NFC East team wins one single playoff game. No way.
Wrong. All right, guys, we're going to take a quick little break. On the other side of the break, we're going to break down some more NFL games. We have the Bills, Broncos, Cowboys, 49ers, Chiefs, Saints, Buck, Falcons, and talk a little bit Titans, Colts as well. Right after this on the Man Hour break will be Buck. Be sure to what did he say?
Make sure Combs follows up.
Oh, Combs always follows up.
We're gonna right back, guys. Something about his bet.
And welcome back to the Man Hour, guys. Michael Buckheiser with Combs and Wyatt as well, guys. Head over to MikeAndMikeManHour.com. Pick yourself up some merchandise. We have some new t-shirts. Combs, show them that awesome hoodie that you got there.
Look at this.
Give your girl a shout-out.
Big shout-out to Roe & Co. Customs. She made this hoodie for me. She made some t-shirts for my kids when I go to see them for Christmas. Got some cool stuff out there, so I'll be using her for a lot more stuff. So make sure you check her out on Facebook. That's Roe, R-O-W-E, and Co. Customs.
So Tori Anderson says, I will bet Combs a day of drinking at Brewers Scrubs game at Miller Park.
Oh, I am. What are we betting on? Wait, what are we betting on here?
Who drinks? What is it? He drinks more or what?
Tori, what are we betting? I will come see a Brewers Cubs game at Miller Park. I love watching the Brewers get beat down by the Cubs. Absolutely.
Yep. All right, guys. Let's go ahead and transition to some more NFL talk. We've seen some battles happening over the weekend, and one of the biggest battles that we saw, biggest playoff information here, was the Cowboys beating the 49ers 41-33. We said it before, guys. I mean, obviously, this is a part of the way or no way. I mean, I already know you guys' answer, but is there any way the Cowboys can make it to the playoffs right now, Wyatt?
No. I'm not even explaining myself. Just no. I'm just going to move on to Combs. Just go ahead. Take it, Combs. Just take it, man. I'm not doing this.
We've already talked about this. The Cowboys are not making the playoffs. Your Cowboys, you and your boy LeBlanc, your Cowboys are dead. They're done. Done.
They are not done because they are on a two-game winning streak. They have scored 30-plus points the last 2 weeks. I said this way back before. I said the Cowboys were a Super Bowl team with Andy Dalton as a quarterback. Granted, he did come in. I believe it was week 4 or week 5, like I said. It said he would. But he did miss 3 weeks or four weeks.
You predicted Dak's injury?
I did not predict Dak's injury, but I predicted Dak would be playing bad, which he wasn't playing bad.
They beat the Bengals,
and
they beat the 49ers.
Okay.
They did not beat – the 49ers have 95% of their team on the COVID list, and you just said that's the whole reason why Ohio State didn't play well versus Northwestern.
Let me go ahead and pull this page out of Combs' book.
Did they win?
Yes, they won, and they won soundly. I think the Cowboys are the team to beat in the NFC East right now. They have to. Cowboys were done when they hired Mike McCarthy. Running wasn't.
Agreed. Mike McCarthy was. Ask Wyatt. Wyatt knows all about Mike McCarthy. Mike McCarthy is a trash coach. He's not a good coach. He horrible clock management, horrible play calling. He physically can't run.
I said this from the day I saw they hired him. He physically doesn't run the ball. They're a run first team. They have Zeke and that offensive line and a mobile quarterback. They are a run first team. Why would you hire a guy who his entire career hasn't been top 15? He's been bottom 10 of the league in run game.
Preach it, Wyatt. Preach it.
He's been bottom 10 of the run game his entire coaching career, and you hire him as a run-first head coach? What are we doing here?
Let me ask you this.
It's like, why would I hire a chef to give me a haircut?
Well, because they know because you're good with knives and scissors, but that's the point. Name one
team. Is that
team.
Who cut your hair, Buck?
Let's not talk about that. But let me ask you guys this: name a team in this generation of football that is a run first team that is going to win a Super Bowl. You can't, can you?
The Titans?
No, they're not going to win a Super Bowl. They're knocked out in the first round.
They can.
They won't.
The Titans absolutely could win the Super Bowl.
They could, but they won't.
The Pittsburgh Steelers are a run-first team, even though they haven't been the last few weeks, but they are a run-first team.
There is not one run-first team that's going to win the Super Bowl. So,
are you, Clemson, are you seeing this game right now? It's 17 to nothing. They're losing to the 2-10-1 Bengals right now. They're getting throttled.
Because
the Pittsburgh Steelers are overrated, like I said.
Hey, speaking of which, who picked the Bengals to win this game?
Buck did. I said it would be close. I said Pittsburgh wins in a close one. Buck said
Bengals win. Wyatt, look, I know you're young, and I know you usually go to bed by the time our show is over, so you don't always hear it all. First rule of thumb, don't ever admit that Buck was right. Ever. If he says who picked this, be like, I don't know, I can't remember.
Moving on to the next one. The Buffalo Bills thumped the Denver Broncos at Mile High Stadium 48-19. Combs, will the Buffalo Bills win the AFC this year?
They are the biggest threat to the Kansas City Chiefs. The Buffalo Bills are so sneaky good, and people don't even talk about them. The Buffalo Bills are good. That front seven is a top five front seven in the NFL. That defense is so good. That team can absolutely bring it to anybody in the AFC, including the Kansas City Chiefs. And the Kansas City Chiefs like to sleep on their competition. If they sleep on the Buffalo Bills, I'm telling you right now, Buffalo will roll them.
I'm kind of rolling on what Combs is saying here. I'm going to say no because KC is so good. I mean, we saw what they did with the Saints. They are ridiculous, okay? But I will say, yes.
Suck up show?
The Bills are the biggest threat to Kansas City. I 100% agree with Combs on that. But I don't think so. Kansas City, God, they look so good right now. I don't think I know the Steelers couldn't come up against them, but I think the Bills will be the biggest threat, and I don't think they're good enough to do it. I don't think their offense is strong enough to keep up with Kansas City's offense.
When you post this on Spotify and all that, you need to change the name from Stunning Changes in the NFL to Wyatt Sucks Up to Buck. The entire show.
So I am clearly a Chiefs fan, and I will always root for my Chiefs 100%. But watching the Bills play at Mile High Stadium, which is a tough place to play, whether you guys want to admit it or like or not, like I know you were at, like in my Texas, like, oh, I thought Mile High was a tough place. Like, it is a tough place to play, 100%. The altitude, the snow, the wind, all that stuff. And then, granted there were no fans, but it's still a tough place to play. Buffalo Bills. They scare me because I think Josh Allen is a top five quarterback in the league. Stephon Diggs is proving that, you know, he was not a prima donna in Minnesota. Minnesota just didn't like success. So they're like, leave, right? So, and that defense is exactly what you said, Combs. If the Chiefs have to play the Buffalo Bills in a early game, I'm talking like the second, like the, wow. Moving on.
I got rid of that last week, Tori.
Tori, man, you have been great in the chat tonight, man. I definitely appreciate it here. So, awesome. But I don't think the Buffalo Bills make it to the Super Bowl because I think we saw a Super Bowl preview last night, the Kansas City Chiefs versus the Saints. Yes, Michael Thomas is on IR. Drew Brees looked pretty rusty the first quarter, but the Chiefs did win 32-29. Combs, was this a Super Bowl preview?
Yeah, but first, I don't know if Wyatt has car bunk beds, but I think every time he sees Buck, for Christmas, did he give you like a wrapped up like a coffee mug or something that said world's best teacher or coach or something?
It actually says world's greatest dad. So.
Oh, okay. Perfect. Yeah, that makes a ton of sense now. All right, gotcha. But what was the question here? The Chiefs Super Bowl preview?
Combs old, Saints. Forgetting. The dementia setting in.
It is. But no, it was not a Super Bowl preview. The Saints are not going to win the NFC. The Tampa Bay Buccaneers are going to win the NFC. I laugh if you want to, but the Tampa Bay Buccaneers are finally starting to find out how to win, and how to win is to let Tom Brady do what he needs to do. I listened today, and something I heard was the best thing that I've heard all the time. Is why are the Bucks so bad in the first half but so good in the second half? It's because in the first half they're doing all the things that Bruce Arians teaches them how to do all week long, and then in the second half they look to number 12 and say, "Hey, what do we got to do to win this thing?" And that's when they start winning this thing. That is what it is. I'm telling you right now, the Tampa Bay Buccaneers are for real, and the Tampa Bay Buccaneers are going to win this NFC. You heard it here first.
So the Buccaneers are much like what the Chiefs are. They look down to the competition. Well, you cannot look down to your competition and follow Bruce Arians for a first half and then expect to come back every game. It just doesn't work like that, Combs. It just
worked for the Chiefs last year.
How did it work for the Chiefs last year?
That's what they came back in every damn game.
In the second quarter, not the second half. Come on.
No, the second half. It was the second half of every single one of those games.
Second
except
quarter.
Except for... Oh, God, give me a break.
You are so
anyway,
horrible at life.
They once it comes to playoff time, who knows how to win in the playoffs more than Tom Brady?
Andy Reid and Patrick Mahomes.
Andy Reid, actually, before he met Patrick Mahomes, did not know how to win so much in the postseason.
You don't
believe
that
me?
One,
go ask Eagles fans. Hey, where'd our boy Blake go? Hey, Blake, how did Andy Reid do in the playoffs when he was in Philadelphia?
You believe he went to four straight NFC championships? Yeah, he went to four straight NFC East or NFC championships.
Yes, and then his clock management cost him every single damn game in there. It cost him the damn Super Bowl against the Patriots. His clock management is awful. It's always been awful. And that's what cost him that damn Super Bowl against the Patriots. Don't know when to call a timeout. Don't know how to run a two-minute offense.
Can I address this? Tori, my wife, does have me chained to the to the garage. So,
Tori, that he is actually right now in Iraq shooting a propaganda film. So we just do the show when he's, you know, in between shoots.
So moving on to the Bucks Falcon game. Speaking of Tom Brady, they were down 17-0 in the first half. The comeback to win, I believe the score was 27-24, if I'm not mistaken. Are the Falcons the worst second half team ever that you guys have ever seen?
Yes. Yes. I don't know. Like you guys, I'm super young. I know that. Like I did not watch a ton of it, as much NFL as you guys have in your life. But I've done a crap ton of rewatching old games and stats and documentaries and stuff to boost my knowledge on older games and stuff. But I don't know in my mind ever of any team in NFL history that is this bad with a lead. It's almost like if you're playing them, and I talked about this a little bit pre-show meeting with you guys. It's almost like if you're playing them and they have a lead at half, it's a good thing. You should be happy about that. You should be like, oh, okay, that's awesome. Okay, they got the lead. It's time for us to turn this on. They're going to fall apart. We'll move on. It's fine. We'll win.
Look, 28-3 in the Super Bowl against the Patriots with 2:38 to go in the third quarter. 30-20 on the San Diego Chargers in the fourth quarter with 5:59 to go. 17-0 on the Miami Dolphins in the third quarter with 12 minutes to go. 39-24 on the Dallas Cowboys in the fourth quarter with 4 minutes and 57 seconds to go. 26-10 on the Bears in the fourth quarter with 6 minutes and 22 seconds to go. 24-7 on the Tampa Bay Buccaneers in the third quarter with 4 minutes and 35 seconds to go in the third. Lost
so
every single one of those games.
That's so bad.
It's not even a question. These guys are the worst second-half team in the history of the NFL.
Can I derail and go back to the Chiefs here real quick, guys? Because Timothy Litters says, really, Buck, the Chiefs came back in the second half of the AFC Championship game. That is complete false. The Chiefs were down 17-7 going into the second quarter, and the Chiefs scored 14 points within, like, 2 minutes of each other, right? Giving them a, I believe it's 21-17.
What about that Texans game the week before? They were down by over 20 points.
Yeah, they came back in the second quarter, though, because
all
it was about to
their,
go to halftime.
All
and
of
I left to
the
grocery
the
store.
Yeah, all of the
I left to go to the grocery
quarter.
Store, and my girlfriend's dad called me up. It's literally a two-minute drive to the grocery store. It's four blocks away. And my girlfriend's dad called me up and said, you're not going to believe this. I said, what? He's like, the Chiefs have the lead. I said, what? What are you talking about? I just left the house, and they were down by 21. Yeah.
It was crazy.
Yeah. And then Blake Zender comes and says, Buck, you're a fake Chiefs fan.
Oh, my God.
Oh.
Wow. Okay.
You're 12. Anything off in the last.
All righty, guys. So moving on to the last topic before we get to the two-minute warning here. Titans and Colts both win last week. Who is more dangerous in the playoffs? Combs, you in the AFC, who do you not want to play, Titans or Colts?
I would say the Titans, because I don't want to face Derrick Henry in that run game. Derrick Henry showed last year in the playoffs what he could do in the playoffs. I believe he played three games in the playoffs and ran for like 400 and something yards. It was absolutely ridiculous what he did in the playoffs last year. And I'm sorry, but when it comes to playoff time, and I know I've said this all season long, but I just don't trust Phillip Rivers to get it done. And I like the Colts. I like what they're doing over there in Indy. I didn't like the signing of Phillip Rivers at first, but it's proven to be good. But when it comes to playoff time, man, I'd be more scared of the Titans than I am the Colts.
See, so this is a tough one for me. I'm kind of going off what Combs said here, because it's basically a high-powered offense versus a high-powered defense. And the way I chose on this one was I thought, how would they match up against each other, which we've already seen a couple of times. But I'm choosing the Titans simply because I don't think Indy's offense kind of bounced off what Combs said, like I said just a second ago. I don't trust Phillip Rivers. I don't think that in a shootout or in any game, really, I don't think that Phillip Rivers and that offense will be able to keep up with Tannehill and the Titans offense. I mean, we talk about Derrick Henry. Yes, he's great. I have him on my fantasy team. He's won me the last two weeks. He's put out a ton of points for me. He racks up a ton of yardage, gets up a ton of carries. But I mean, Tannehill threw for five touchdowns. He had five touchdowns last week. Ran for two, threw for three. I mean, I think it's time we start looking at Tannehill as possibly the ringleader there as well, because he is amazing on offense.
Yeah, so I believe it was a couple weeks ago I said when Ryan Tannehill was in Miami, he took 2 years off of his career, so he was like a sophomore in college playing in the NFL underneath Adam Gase. Ever since he has become starter in Tennessee, he has progressed tremendously into definitely a top-10 quarterback in the league, probably going on next year. But Phillip Rivers is 4-4 in the playoffs, and when you go into the playoffs, yes, it is all 0-0, but it's also about experience. The Tennessee Titans experienced a lot last year, beating the Patriots, the almighty Patriots. Tom Brady was still on there. They beat the MVP and Lamar Jackson, and they basically took them to the woodshed. They took their offense off of the field, and then, yes, they did lose to the Kansas City Chiefs in the AFC Championship game, but it comes down to coaching, too. Would you rather have Mike Vrabel or Frank Wright? Right now, Vrabel looks like a damn good coach. You know, quite arguably, maybe a coach of the year right now. Like, I'm taking the Titans because I don't want to play them as a Chiefs fan, because we've seen them. They literally take offenses out of the game with the defensive strategy that they have and the running game that they have. I don't want to face the Titans at all. All right, guys. That's going to take us to the two-minute warning.
That'll bring us to the two-minute warning.
Look, we were talking a little bit today about Trevor Lawrence, and I said that Trevor Lawrence is a bust. And a lot of people come at me with, how can you say that? This guy is, if you built a prototype of an NFL quarterback, you would build Trevor Lawrence. I disagree. The guy cannot throw the ball more than 30 times a game, because if he does, his numbers go way, way, way down. Okay, so this guy, over the course of his career, most games, he's up over 70% passing until he gets to 30 attempts or more. You look at 2018, he had three games where he had 30 attempts or more. All three of those games, he was under 65% completion percentage. You look at 2019, the loss against Louisiana State, he was 18 for 37, 48%. Completion percentage. Ohio State in 2018, 18 for 33 with a 54% completion percentage. You look at this year alone, there's only been a couple times where he's actually thrown more than 30 times, but in both games, his yards are down, his completion percentage is down. He does not do well when he has to throw the ball more than 30 times. So the aberration is one game per year he does all right, and he did all right this last game against Notre Dame. But once he gets over that 30 attempt mark, he does not fare well. And you cannot be an NFL quarterback and not be able to throw the ball more than 30 times per game. This kid is not going to be the superstar that everybody thinks he's going to be. The best quarterback coming out of this draft is Kyle Trask. Write it down. I said it first. I'm telling you guys right now, Buck Wyatt, I don't know if you guys believe me, but this is what it is. This guy is not going to be the superstar that everybody says he's going to be in the NFL.
Go ahead, my bad.
No, you're good, buddy. The only way that he will be a bust is if he goes to the Jets or the Jaguars. That is the only, or a terrible team like that with a historically bad front office that won't get pieces around him. That is the
only way. He's going to have to throw the ball more than 30 times.
You like to mention that. Every game you mentioned was in his sophomore season. That was his bad year.
I mentioned look at his freshman year.
He is look at what he's done this year. He's a Heisman candidate. How can you say someone's bad if they're a Heisman candidate? A Heisman candidate is the top college football player in the entire nation. It means you are number one. That means if you're even at contention, you're top four in the entire nation at that. I will say, I think Trask will go on to probably, if he goes somewhere like the Jets, Trask will probably have a better career because Trask is going to be like Mahomes. Nobody really knew him. Mahomes slips down to the 10th pick, goes to the Chiefs. He has weapons there. I think that's probably the best fit for Trask is if he goes somewhere like that. Same with Lawrence, though. And also the other thing, if he gets with an NFL team, I mean, these guys are professionals. I know Lamar hasn't been insanely good and he can't win in the playoffs, but think about Lamar, his rookie year versus now throwing the ball. He is a much more accurate quarterback now, and he has developed into a passing quarterback now over running simply because he has NFL coaches that are behind him, backing him, pushing him to be better, showing him how to read defenses better, showing him how to even throw the ball better, working on his passing mechanics. I mean, Patrick Mahomes didn't know how to read a defense till a year or two after he won, right before he won the Super Bowl, right? That's what he said. And I mean, it's just, there's no way he's a bust. I don't know if he'd be a bust if he went to somewhere like, I mean, the Jets, yes, I could see that 100%, but I don't even know about Jacksonville.
I know you probably don't know this name because you're like 8 years old.
Ryan Leaf. Knew it. How about that?
That's who Trevor Lawrence is. Ryan Leaf all over again.
I don't think he will be that bad. He will be a bust because of the team that he goes to, not because of the type of player that he is.
Absolutely.
I was on the Trevor Lawrence bus train long ago just because I've seen his progression through college, and he doesn't know how to lose. I think he has like 5 career losses ever in his whole football life. And when you go to somebody like the Jets or the Jaguars, you're going to lose a lot. And I don't know if you can really bounce back from that if you don't. It is you have to learn how to lose, right? And like people say, you learn more from losing, yada yada yada, but you also break down more. Look at Vince Young. Vince Young was getting beat down in Tennessee, and he like mentally just broke down. I can see Lawrence doing that in the pros.
Yeah, I'm telling this guy. I agree. I mean, whoever goes to the Jets is not going to. I mean, they're not going to be good for a long time, unless they do something very, very smart with their draft picks here, and that is not actually using them. That's trading them to get better. So the New York Jets have got to do something no matter who they draft to get better, but they're not getting better unless they do something drastic. So I agree with that, but this kid cannot throw the ball more than 30 times a game, and if you have to in the NFL to be a successful quarterback, you're throwing the ball more than 30 times a game. Either way.
All right, guys, that's going to be it for the Man Hour. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in tonight. That means a lot to us. Join us tomorrow. It'll be our last show of the year. We're going to have a lot of fun tomorrow. So 9 o'clock East Coast time is where you can find us, youtube.com/Man Hour. We have some votes going on over there. Speaking of voting, the football team won the votes over there. People think the NFC East is going to be won by the football team. But, guys, that's going to be it for the Man Hour. Catch you guys tomorrow, same time, same place.